So good afternoon all of you and welcome back to Excelsior Academy. So this is the lecture third from the MolBio series, and the textbook or the reference book which I'm using for MolBio is Watson. Okay. So in the previous lectures we talked about the double helical structure complementarity of the DNA structure, right? And we also discussed about the major and minor groups. Now we last class also I have said that in the major group more information is present. What does it mean? It means that the most of the enzymes or any catalytic activity which takes place, it's happening only at the major group. Why? Because it is giving the space for the enzymes to get bind. Okay. Whereas in the case of minor group, the space is less and hence none of the enzymes are able to bind and no catalytic activity will take place. So in the major group, most of the chemical reactions take place. So we'll just discuss in detail about the major groups and minor groups. So as a result of the double helical structure of the two chains, the DNA molecule is long extended polymer with two grooves that are not equal in size to each other. Now what you have to remember with respect to your exam point of view is this. So the angle at which two sugars protrude from the base. So what they're saying is that, so we know that in nucleotide we have got phosphate, sugar and the base, right? So the angle between the sugar and the base is 120 in the case of minor and 240 in the case of major group. Okay, the angle between the glycosidic bonds. So the glycosidic bonds, as discussed in the last class, it is formed between the sugar and the base. So this angle is 120 in the case of minor and 240 in the case of major. Now because of this, what happens? There is a wide angle in the case of major group. Okay, so what you have to remember, this point. So the angle at which two sugars protrude from the base pair. So the angle between the glycosidic bonds is 120 for the minor and 240 degree for the major. Now, so because of this, what will happen? More and more base pairs stack on top of each other. The narrow angle between the sugars on one edge of the base pair generates minor group and the larger angle will generate major group. Obviously, right? So you have got less space in the case of minor and more space in the case of major group. Now please remember these values also because it helps in actually calculating the answers whenever you are doing the problems based on the DNA structures. Okay, so this you need to remember. So what all things we need to remember, that the one nucleotide weight is around 330 Dalton. One base pair is 650 Dalton. Okay. And now this also. And in DNA, one helix is having 10.5 base pairs per helical turn. Okay. So all these you need to remember because in future, when we are going to do more problems based questions, so all these values are going to be helpful. And the distance between two nucleotides is 3.3. In some cases, it is given 3.4 also. Okay. Angstrom. Okay, so if the sugars pointed away from each other in a straight line at an angle of 180, then the two grooves would be equal dimension. So what does it mean? It means that if suppose phosphate, sugar are like this, if they were in this angle, then the major and minor group won't be there. It will be proper having the equal dimension. Then there won't be any major and minor, only one kind of group will be present. But we know that they make a certain angle and originally it is present over here. Okay. So that's why you get an angle. If suppose it was having the straight line and having 180 degree angle, then the grooves will be of equal dimensions. Okay. So the edges of each base pair are exposed in the major and minor groups, creating a pattern of hydrogen bond donors and the acceptors. Now this is very, very, very important. Okay. This is very important. Now the edge of 80 base pair displays the following chemical groups. Now let us see the 80. Okay. This is GC I have kept over here. Sorry. In the next we have got. One second. Okay, so here we have got the 80. Oh, I got misplaced. So GC is over there and 80 over here. So what you can see is over here is, so what are the chemical groups present? Here you have got the N, which will act as the A stands for your hydrogen bond acceptor. Okay, so this is your acceptor. Then H means donor, hydrogen bond donor. So if you see over here, we have got the amino group at the sixth carbon position in the purine. Okay, this is your A, adenine. Then what you see, you have got the acceptor, donor, and then again you have got the acceptor. So you see that over here the hydrogen bond is formed, and then the hydrophobic small group is there, which is called methyl. Okay, so what is the major group it is showing? It is showing the ADAM, Adam. So Adam in case of AT base pairing. Is this clear? A is hydrogen bond acceptor, donor, acceptor, methyl group, hydrophobic group. Okay. So if I say that in the major group, Adam is present, it means what kind of base pairing is present? AT base pairing is present. Okay. Now, how the enzymes are able to differentiate is based on these chemical interactions only. So if you have got MADA, it means then it is TA base pairing. So based on these chemical interactions, enzymes are able to differentiate between AT and TA base pairing. Is it clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Now, similarly, in the case of GC also. So, if I go back. So, in over here also, if you see. Now, this is for the GC. So, what you are getting in the case of GC base pairing? We have
A, DH,
right? So you can see that this is also acceptor, this is also acceptor, this is donor, and then H. H means no group is present. Now, if you take CG base pairing, you have got HDAA. So here we are having AADH in the case of GC and HDAA in the case of CG. So again, you're able to differentiate between these two types of base pairing. Agree? So this is what you need to remember. So it is the C6 exocyclic. What do you mean by exocyclic? It means outside the cycle, amino group is present. Okay, like this. Okay. So this is what you need to remember. Otherwise, it's very easy. So if you can remember that Adam and Mada is present in the AT and TA base pairing, then in this case, AADH and HDAA base pairing is present in the case of GC and CG base pairing. Okay. So this means what all these are giving the chemical information present in the major group. So major group is rich in chemical information because it gives you the acceptor and donor interaction. It is very important because these are also in future, what I meant is like in further chemical reactions, whenever any proteins or enzymes comes and bind to them. So they act as the acceptor and donor. So it is important. Okay. So third, that these are the characteristic patterns of hydrogen bonding and of overall shape that are exposed in the major group. So it is going to distinguish between the AT and GC base pairing. It also differentiates AT from being TA base pairing, right? So finally, you can differentiate between the AT, you can differentiate TA, GC, CG. So this is also different, this is different, and this is different. So each base pairing is different from each other. Okay. Now, if certain codes are given, so this is what is, like I already mentioned actually. So hydrogen bond acceptor is given as A, donor is given as D, methyl group M, and nothing is there, so then it is hydrogen. So if suppose Adam is present in the major group, it means it is AT. If AADH is present, it means it is GC. Now, if I ask a question, if it is HDAA, so what kind of base pairing it is? CG. Yes, CG base pairing. Good. So now you got the idea, right? So whenever anyone asks you what kind of chemical information you get from the major group, so you need to talk about the hydrogen bond acceptor, donor, methyl group, or the nonpolar hydrogen. Okay. So what kind of chemical information? It is telling you what kind of base pairing is present. Either it is AT, TA, GC, or CG. Okay. So similarly, MADA stands for TA and HDAA stands for CG base pairing. So now in all these cases, the code of chemical groups in the major group specifies the identity of the base pair. So how many code we learned today? We have got Adam. We have MADA, Mada. Then we have got AADH and HDAA, right? So this is for AT, this is for GC, this is for TA, and this is for CG. Now, so these all patterns are important because they will allow proteins to recognize the DNA sequence without having to open and thereby disrupt the double helix. So what does it mean? So if I have double helix like this, okay, so if any protein is coming, it doesn't need to open the DNA structure. So from the major group, wherever it is present, it can just go and bind and recognize the sequences. Now, whatever minor group. So in the case of minor group, it is not rich in chemical information. Why? Because it is not able to distinguish between the base pairs. Now, why it is not able to distinguish? Because it doesn't have the space. As the angle is also small, the base stacking is small, so it is not able to give you any information. And because of which, what will happen? It cannot accommodate amino acid side chains. Now, what amino acid side chains they are talking? They're talking about the amino acid side chains of the enzymes or the proteins which go and interact with the DNA sequences. Okay, so it cannot accommodate them. Now, these amino acids are the amino acids which are involved in the interaction or the catalytic activity of the proteins or the enzymes. Okay, now in the case of minor group, ATTA base pairs and GCCG base pairs, they look similar in the minor group. So if you have seen the figure, now this is in the case of AT. So what do you see in the case of AT minor group? So already we discussed Adam is there, MADA MARA is there. Okay, in case of AT and TA base pairing, but that time I didn't mention about the minor group. Now let's talk about the minor group. So if I take about the minor group, so I have got the N3 of the adenine as the acceptor, again a hydrogen is there, and then again the acceptor is there, right? So this is AHA. Now in the case of AT base pair, now let us talk about TA base pairing. Here also again I have A, H and A. Now if the enzyme comes and see AHA and AHA, either from this direction or this direction, will the enzyme be able to distinguish between the two? No, right? So enzymes cannot distinguish between whether it is having the AT base pairing or the TA base pairing. And hence, none of the proteins will go and bind to the minor group because it is not providing the space, it is not providing any kind of information. Is it clear to everyone?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes. Similarly, in the case of GC and CG pairing, so we know that AADH and HDAA, right? So GC and CG you can distinguish, but when you're talking about the minor group, you see that ADA and ADA is present again. So ADA. So again, it is not able to distinguish between the minor groups. It is not able to distinguish between the GC pairing with the CG pairing. So what it can do, only one thing. And what is that? It can only distinguish between the AT and GC base pairing. Whereas in the case of minor, in the case of major, we had AT, TA, GC and CG. All the four can be distinguished, right? Because every four pairing had different code. But here we had AHA and ADA. Right, so only these two can be distinguished by the enzymes. But whether it is AT or TA, GC or CG, it cannot distinguish. And hence, very few proteins will go and bind to the minor group of your DNA sequence. Is that clear, everything about the major and minor group of the DNA? Yeah?
Yes, ma'am. Yes.
Okay. So the same thing. Thus, from the point of view of hydrogen bonding, CG and GC base pairs do not look very different from each other. It means they are similar. So the minor group does look different when comparing AT base pair with GC, but GC and CG or AT and TA cannot be distinguished. Now let's talk about the different conformations of DNA. So we have got three types of DNA. B-DNA, A-DNA and Z-DNA. Okay. So whenever you pronounce, always say Z, don't say Z. Okay. It is Z. Now, so the commonly occurring DNA is the B form. So whatever we have got the B form of DNA. What you need to remember is it has got 10 Now, once we do the further exercise and all, so we come to know that it is 10.5. To be very precisely, it is 10.5 base pairs per turn. Okay, and the A form is there. Now, what you have to remember is that this B form have got the 10.5 base pair under high humidity. Now, what do you mean by high humidity? What is the meaning of high humidity? It means high amount of water. Okay. And in the case of A, if it is low humidity, you will see that 11 base pair per turn is there. So what do you mean by per turn? If you see in the figure, like this, this is one complete turn. Okay, or one complete helix. So in this much, you have got 10.5 in the case of B and 11 base pairs in the case of A DNA. Okay. So it's a major groove which is narrow and much deeper than that of the B form, and it is minor groove which is broader and shallow in the case of A DNA. So when you compare A DNA and B DNA, now if you see the structure over here, you can see that the center is not hollow in the case of B, whereas in the case of A, you have got the space, right? Now, whereas in the case of Z, this is both right-handed DNA and this is left-handed DNA, if you observe carefully. So, they have given the rotation also. See, over here, this direction they have given. So, it is right-handed. Now, whereas in the case of Z-DNA, it is left-handed and it is called Z because if you see the structure, this one, it looks zigzag. So, based on the zigzag structure, the name is given as Z-DNA. Okay, so there is a table where the differences and similarities of B, A and Z-DNA is given. Very frankly, I'm telling you guys, you need to remember everything from that table. Okay, because based on that only the problems, questions based on the DNA structures can be solved. Now, one more thing. So, as I was saying, the distance between the two, I mentioned as 3.3 angstrom, right? So, I told you, in few textbook, it is given as 4 also. So, either you can write as 3.3 angstrom or 3.4 nanometer, and the turn is having your 3.4 nanometer. Okay. So, in one turn, the 10 base pair is there, right? In one helix turn, and the length is around 3.4 nanometer. Is this clear and this clear? Can you see the difference? It is 0.34 nanometer, the distance between the two nucleotides. 3.4 nanometer is the length of the 10 base pairs. That is one helical turn. Am I clear over here?
Please. Yes, yes, ma'am.
Okay. Now, this is something which is not given in most of the textbooks, but it is important to know. So, we now know that the average 10.5 base pairs are present in per turn of the helix in the case of B form DNA. Okay. So, always whenever we draw the structure or study, we always say that it is a perfect helical structure. But in reality, it is not. And now, how we came to know about this? It is based on the crystallographic structures. So, I'll teach crystallography also once I get the time. So, it is based on the crystallographic structure, that is your X-ray diffraction. So, the crystals of DNA were made and it was diffracted using X-rays, and it was understood that it is not having the perfect base stacking. Okay, now because of the helical structure, it has got the propeller twist. Now, what do you mean by the propeller twist? Can you see the twist in the hydrogen bond over here? Whenever there is a base stacking in the helical turn, can you see the twist over the hydrogen bond? Yeah. So that is called the propeller twist. So in this arrangement, what happens is the two flat bases are counter rotating related to each other along the long axis of the base pair. So what is the long axis over here? This is the axis. Okay. So because of this rotation in the hydrogen bond, it is having the propeller like character. So your DNA is not actually a regular double helical structure. It has got the propeller twist. Okay. Now, DNA can sometimes form a left-handed helix. So in this, we are going to talk about the Z-DNA, zigzag DNA. So DNA contains alternate purine and pyrimidine residues. They can also fold into left and right. Now, to understand the left-handed helix, you need to understand the structure. So in that case, what happens is the bond is formed between the sorry in the case of left handed helix, the bonds are formed because of the first position of the two deoxyribose. So what happens is that two conformation comes, one is called syn, the other one is called anti. Okay, now in case of bDNA it is anti, and in case of zDNA it is syn. A and B DNA has got the anti conformation of the ribose sugar. Okay, the sugar we are talking about over here, so it has got two conformations, syn and anti. Now A and B DNA has got the anti conformation and Z DNA has got the syn conformation. Now let's see what do you mean by this anti and syn conformation. Now look at the structure over here. So this is your sugar. Can you understand over here which one is the sugar? So this one is your sugar. Okay, and then you have got the guanosine. This is your G. Okay, now you see the attachment over here. When it is attached over here to N9, so you have got your C2 dash this side and C3 dash this side. This is your antiposition. Can you understand? Are you able to imagine? See your ribose sugar, something like this it is, right? And then you have got the bonding. This is a phosphate group present and all. Phosphate group. This is 5-phosphate here and this is 3-OH attached to another group. Can you imagine the structure? This is your 5-carbon present over here. So when it is attached, if you have got, if you consider this plane like this, not like that, sorry. One second, let me draw the straight line. Okay, if you consider this as the plane, of the plane you can see that C2 is present on the above and C3 dash is on the below. So this becomes your antiposition. Now if you have got C3 above and C2 below, this becomes your syn position. Now it is clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so this is your one entire nucleotide is present. So you have got the base, sugar and the phosphate group present. So if you draw the structure, so now where the hydrogen bonding is taking place? From here. This is G, so three bonds will be there, correct? So in the case of A and B DNA, I'll have three hydrogen bonds formed over here. So the same thing is written over here also, so let's read. So the rotation that affects the change from anti to syn also causes the sugar group to undergo a change in its pucker. That is C3 dash and C2 dash can switch locations. So this is the location I was talking about. So if you make a plane over here, C2 dash and C3 dash is there. If they change their location, what will happen? It becomes from anti to syn. Okay. Now in solution, alternating purine and pyrimidine residues assume left-handed conformation only in the presence of high concentrations of positively charged ions like Na plus that shield the negative charge phosphate groups. This point is very important. Okay, so now if suppose in the interview it is asked why most of the DNA takes left-handed conformation, so you can say that if they are present in the high concentration of positively charged ions, like high concentration of salt, right, when you have got Na plus in excess, so it will shield the negative charge of the phosphate group. Now because of which there will be a puckering in the sugar, that is your ribose sugar. Now this puckering means what? C2 dash, C3 dash, the change in the location will be there. And hence it will be in its syn formation, resulting in the left-handed structure. Is it clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. See, if it is not clear, I can repeat, okay? Don't worry about it. I can repeat n number of times. Yes. So this is the table which I was telling that you need to remember. It's very, very, very important. Okay. So you have got the rise per base area. So this I was telling. So 3.3 you need to remember. So see, it's the same textbook. In few places they have given 3.4 and here in the table they have given 3.3. Now helix packing, helix rotation, right-handed, everything. Then base per turn of the helix 10, but actually it is 10.5. Okay, so remember as 10.5 only. Then both A and B has got the anti-glycosyl bond formation, whereas in the case of Z DNA, it is the syn. Okay. Now, anti at C and syn at G means what? So, wherever guanosine will be present, it will have the syn conformation. Wherever cytosine is present, it will have the anti conformation. So, this table you need to by heart.
Okay, ma'am.
Now, this is the assignment. So, what is the assignment? You need to solve this question. So, please write down now. And tomorrow we'll discuss this question. So, the question is, if a fragment of double-stranded DNA has 130...
Ma'am, unable to hear your voice.
Can you read it? Just write down this question. If a fragment of double-stranded DNA has 135 hydrogen bonds and we have 23 guanine bases, what will be the length of the DNA? So, this is the assignment. I hope you get all the answer for this. Otherwise, we'll solve it tomorrow. Okay. Yes. So, thank you for listening.